Hi everyone, my name is Rebecca Robles. I'm the founder of a sustainability design studio called Rhizome. So Rhizome primarily works with decor, with sustainable materials and processes. Lately, as in just last year, we started our sustainable jewelry brand Bucca, which is our first foray into sustainable fashion. We work a lot with craft. So when Falguni from Ciceroni reached out to us saying, could you do a segment on craft or could you do a small video on craft for our Ciceroni sustainability series, we were wildly excited because this is something like we have a lot to say about. And because we have a lot to say about, I actually made fold-outs so that I stay focused. Okay, so the first reason why craft is important to sustainability is because it's local. So craft is generally made in different localities using local materials, local production techniques, and originally it was made for the local people. So if you look at textile crafts like Ajrak, they were made in particular colors because of some colors which communities would wear. Or if you would look at a particular shape of an earthen pot or that kind of a craft, it would be a particular shape because of the utility of that pot. So even if you look at the craft of temple building, the temples of North India, the temples of South India, all of them are very different and they are very local. Now, why local is important is because the income which you earn from local production actually stays within a local economy, and that means that those craftspeople have livelihoods. Now, livelihoods or money is a very important part of craft, because if craftspeople don't earn a livelihood, they don't earn a daily money, they have to distress migrate. When craft first started out, craftspeople used to make things for their neighbors, for communities who lived around them. When industrialization happened, a lot of industrial produce has penetrated the market. So where somebody would use a bamboo basket, they would now use a plastic basket. So what happens then to the craftspeople who are making bamboo baskets? They suddenly don't have any other source of livelihood and they have to distress migrate. So they're not migrating like we do when we move for better prospects. They are moving for better prospects because they have no other prospects. And it's really a pity, because you see a lot of craftspeople going to cities which are already congested and looking for livelihoods even laborers. So they have really high skills, but they have to take on jobs as labor and de-skilled kind of jobs, just because they have to move out of what is familiar to them. They have to move out of their local. And that's a pity, because their local is very deeply entrenched with the whole idea of a bioregion. So what is a bioregion? So a bioregion is a geographical and a natural concept where if you look at the entire earth, it's comprised of many bioregions. So if you look at bioregions, there would be a desert bioregion and there would be a tropical bioregion, there would be a seaside bioregion. So each of these bioregions would have different quality of soil. And of everything that grows on that earth. So you would have different animals, you would have different plants, human beings would have different natural resources. So if you go to Goa, you will have a lot of shells which you can work with. If you come to Gujarat, you'll have a lot of teak you can work with. So crafts are very much traditionally dependent on bioregions. Okay? But one thing in common across these bioregions generally is those materials are renewable. Okay, so what does it mean, renewable? Generally, if I'm a craftsman, if I'm looking to make something, I will look at what is easily available around me. So probably I might cut off a tree and I might make something out of wood, or I might collect seeds, I might collect shells, I might connect animal skills, I might do a lot of these things. So all of the things I'm getting are from the surface of the earth, so from the biosphere. So unless I really have a huge industry and the wherewithal to dig into the belly of the earth and extract non-renewable resources, you know, I would stick to materials which are above the earth, and most craft people actually do that. So why are materials on top of the earth renewable as compared to materials that grow under the earth? So materials that grow under the earth are, they're created under tremendous pressure and heat, and so you can argue that, you know, even a tree takes 4 to 40 years to grow. So how is that a short period of time? That's not a short period of time at all, but it's definitely a shorter period of time than 40 billion years it takes for petroleum to generate. So it's much easier to renew resources which grow on top of the earth. So when we look at the materials used in craft like terracotta, you don't dig very deep to go to terracotta, you just go to the riverbed. Or silk or any other natural fiber, these are all made from renewable materials which are specific to bioregions. So So the silk which you have in Orissa will be different from the silk which you have, say, in Sialkochi, where you have Mukha silk. And that's why the technique of weaving, the technique of dyeing, all these things are going to be different. And that's why you have these traditional techniques. So when you look at these traditional techniques are deeply entrenched into the lives of trans people. They have different traditions on how to use these techniques. They have different traditions on how to safeguard. What do I mean by this, by tradition? So a lot of craftspeople are actually not craftspeople the year round. So in the monsoon, they don't practice the craft and instead they farm. The possibility of craft along with farming is very important, because every time they farm, they have green cover for the earth. They have food for themselves, which keeps them locally strong against things like drought and other, you know, calamities. They have food for us, and they have a deep sensitivity towards nature and how nature is regenerating, or how to work along with nature. So a lot of things in tradition are also linked to an accountability idea. So if you have somebody who is for example working with leather, he would be very accountable to illnesses cow have, and then he would look at how illnesses which cows have actually contribute to how his leather supply is compromised. So he has interest and a vested interest in maintaining the resource which he has. Similarly, if you go to Malaysia, even though they have forests, and they go to the forest and everybody uses the forest, but every time someone harvests, they put a mark on the tree, so that's called molong, so to mark the tree. So when you mark the tree, the next person who's harvesting knows that this tree has been, or this resource has been tapped, so please move on to the next tree. So the idea of accountability is very, very, very strong traditionally, which means that resources are safeguarded on a community basis. Another important part of accountability is actually pollution. So let me give you an example. If there is a weaver and he's using a lot of toxic dyes, though in craft communities they normally don't, but just imagine that even he is, and he goes and dumps all this effluent into the river, then his neighbor who is also using the same river either to fish in or to bathe in or using the water for agriculture will come and tell him that, you know, hey, you can't be polluting our natural resources like this, because it's compromising my life and it's compromising my quality of life. And that is how communities have very high accountability. Now let's look at a high street product. Its material probably comes from Cambodia. It's made in Vietnam. It's sewn in Bangladesh. It's packaged in the US, and then it comes to India. So nobody really cares and nobody really knows about where the pollution is taking place, because they are just little agents who are working in a factory. They are not owners of a community. They are not owners who have accountability to a bioregion. So when you buy craft, you know that somebody somewhere is being responsible to a particular bioregion. So traditional craft is of course the best thing to do. And it's especially the best thing to do because, traditions are something that are constantly in flux. Traditions are changing. Traditional communities are not wearing what they want to wear anymore. So the craft of Rabari embroidery, for example, would probably soon die because they are not wearing the traditional costumes anymore. So one approach would be to say that, hey, you know, they have to wear their traditional costumes. But I mean, you can't force communities not to aspire for new things. So what can you do? You can actually look at urban craft. You can look at design working with craftspeople, or craftspeople turning designers to making urban crafts or crafts for urban markets. So if you took those same Rabari skirts and you made an A-line skirt out of it, or you made a bag out of it, that would be, in that sense, an evolved craft or an urban craft or a craft for an urban market. So when we tell you that buy craft or buy crafted items, it's not that buy traditional museum pieces. It's like buy anything that is made by hand, buy anything that has a sense of identity, a sense of placefulness. So what is really important about craft is that it's an alternative paradigm. So craft at first used to be the only paradigm, it used to be the only model. If you wanted a shirt stitch, you would go to a tailor, and if you wanted a terracotta pot, you would go to your local potter. But now with industrialization happening, we are in an industrial paradigm where we don't go to these places. We don't go to a single person who has accountability. So the industrial paradigm is very much the paradigm, and this is an alternative paradigm, even if it means going to another restore point. So non-industrial kind of way of living is very difficult to do, but crafts offers you that alternative. So when you look at alternative crafts or contemporary makers, it might be something like this earring that I'm wearing. So if you look at this earring, it is made from aluminium nuggets. It's made by a traditional craftsperson. And you know, this kind of a product is also a craft. If you look at this bag is from a very interesting brand in Delhi who works with recycled leather. And they weave the leather together, which are offshoots of the leather industry, and they make urban crafts from that or new crafts from that. Sometimes they are not even urban. You have a lot of brands who are working with rural communities. So in that sense, they are not urban crafts. They are crafts which are made by rural communities for urban and rural markets. So when you buy a crafted piece, you are buying someone's accountability. You are buying someone's care. You're buying someone's love. You're buying the possibility that kids go to school, because if the livelihood goes to a craftsperson, it means he can buy a better life for his family. He can afford a better life for his family. So you're not buying or you're not contributing to a conglomerate lining its pockets. You're actually contributing to a family. So that's why always, always, when in doubt, and especially if it's the doubt of sustainability, go to a crafted piece. If you can buy a traditional craft, you must buy a traditional craft. But if you can't, look towards urban crafts. But at the end of the day, craft is always inherently sustainable. And craft is inherently the thing and the go-to thing for any sustainability crisis. Thanks.